Welcome to the Proverbs 31 Ministries podcast. My name is Shae Hill, and I'm so happy to be with you today. Joel, we've been having some conversations over the last couple months where we've been tackling a question and diving into all the theological stuff, and I've been learning so much from you. It's been super fun. But today, we have a very special guest with us. Victoria,
so
say hi to the podcast.
Hi.
Hello.
Excited to be here.
Thanks for being with us. Yeah. Will you tell our listeners a little bit about you, what you do at Proverbs, all that good stuff?
Yeah, I'd be glad to. Yeah, so again, my name's Victoria. I am our producer here, so I'm actually normally on the other side of the camera or the microphone, I guess, if you're listening on the podcast. But yeah, I'm excited to be here. Sometimes my job, I get to help just have conversations about content and what we're going to discuss on the podcast and on YouTube. And this was a topic that I feel really passionate about, and I feel like I've been studying for the last several years. And so Joel and Shae were very gracious enough to invite me and let me crash. So yeah, thanks for letting me crash the Ask a Theologian.
Well, thanks for being here.
Victoria's being so humble right now. So let me just,
she
you
is.
Know, let me add.
I know, I was like, who's going to gas her up first, me or you?
Let me go first.
Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
And you gas, you add more gasoline on top of the gasoline that we're going to add on to. We literally could not, honestly, Victoria, like we could not do the things that we do. The ability to have order and flow. God has gifted you with just a brilliant mind. She also has a very difficult task of reigning in creatives. So if you can imagine the Therapy and Theology podcast, like we would not be able to do the Therapy and Theology podcast with Lisa, Jim, and I were it not for Victoria's ability to really schedule that out. And then the other thing that I don't think sometimes people know about you is that you're a legit theologian. Like, you read well, you always have these amazing quotes, you're always, even before episodes, you'll ask great questions, and you're like, oh, I was reading this, and so I'm so excited for this conversation for people to see the theologian side of you.
Exactly.
Oh, thank you.
You're very creative, even though you also are really blessed with systems. Like, you, sometimes I feel like you have to be the therapy and theology hall monitor, where you're like, hey, guys, get in line. It's time.
The hall monitor. The hall monitors used to always get me in trouble, so you know.
And now Victoria has to keep you in line. Here we are. But I think it's such a unique pairing to have someone that's so gifted in like organizations and systems, but also so creative. So you're just a jack of all trades.
Thanks, y'all. I was not expecting to
just get World traveler.
Oh, yeah. I did just get back from France. Yeah. Well, thanks, y'all. I feel like 10 feet tall. This is great.
We recorded this in France.
Right. Yeah,
in hindsight, that would have been fun.
Ask a Theologian abroad, you know. Well, thanks, y'all.
Thanks for being here. Like you said, you were really passionate about the topic that we're going to discuss today. And so before we get into all the things, I feel like I'm here with two theologians today. So this is really Ask My Theologians. I want to make sure I set up our conversation really well. And so today we're going to talk about the struggle, honestly, both inward and outward, of being a Christian who lives on earth. So if you're listening to this and you're a Christian, then that is you. Like this conversation applies to you. Maybe you've heard the commonly used phrase of we're in the world, but we're not of it. But what does that really mean? And is that really true? And what does it look like to not be attached to earth, to hold on to the things of earth with like closed hands and really tightly holding on, almost like a hoarder of things on earth? Mm-hmm. What does it look like to not live like that, but also to be a steward, someone that lives purposefully while they're here on this side of eternity? So what would that healthy attachment or detachment, however you want to look at it, to earth as believers look like? And that's what we're going to talk about today.
Yeah, that's so good, Shae. I was reading the other day, and I believe it was the first time I read kind of this idea was from N.T. Wright, and he presented a few kind of core questions. And I think for our conversation, it might be helpful to start with these kind of core questions that I think if we stripped it down and got to the foundation that all of us are really kind of struggling with, you know, and really the way we think about these questions, the way we answer these questions are going to determine really the actions that we make and the decisions that we make moving forward. So here are kind of these three fundamental questions. The first question is like, who are we? You know, like, have you ever thought about that? Like, got up in the morning, you're just like, who actually am I right now? You know,
only when I'm like, in my most existential crisis moment.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So it's like, okay,
who am
who
I?
Are
what
we?
What is life?
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So like, okay, who are we? The next thing is like, why are we here? You know? Why? Like that big, like, so what am I supposed to do? Like, why am I here? And so if we know who, like, who are we? Why are we here? Then the next question is very practical. So what do we do about it? You know? And so one of the things about the Bible, about the scriptures, that I think is kind of important for us to frame this conversation is that the Bible is moving in three primary movements. And so here's kind of the three categories and the movements, and it actually helps us understand who we are, why we're here, and what we're supposed to do. The first movement is that God is a good God, so he creates good things. So you have creation, and specifically the adjective in front of creation is good creation. And then you have the reality of sin, and sin breaks apart God's good creation. And so the second movement is, the technical phrase would be like decreation or uncreation, that things that were good start to break apart. But here's the deal. God remains good even in the midst of the presence of sin, and a good God isn't just going to sit and allow all these good things that he made to break apart. Mm-hmm. So he steps into creation and he provides a way for all the things that are broken apart to be put back together the way that he intended for it to be. So the last movement is recreation or new creation. And one of the things that happens in this movement is from all the things that are good to all the things that are broken is that in the midst of this brokenness, which is really what we're in right now, the post-Genesis 3 reality, the word or the phrase or the image that the Bible uses to describe this state of being, which I want to be so clear, is not intended to be forever. It is a right now. There is an end in sight. And so we have to deal with that intention. The image is the image of exile. The image is the image of wilderness, you know? And just as a way to describe this, Eden is on a mountain. The mountains were the place where God and man met. Well, when Adam and Eve sin, they're sent out of the mountain. Mm. And they have to leave the Garden of Eden. Now, if you're on top of a mountain and you have to leave the Garden of Eden, well, where are you going? Down. Mm. And so the first image of Adam and Eve leaving is actually an image of exile. They're going into the wilderness. They're going into the reality of separation from God. And yet, something that's kind of fascinating is that God is persistent to actually go into the wilderness with Adam and Eve and with us today because he cares about us and he loves us.
Mm. Wow. That's like a really, it's really powerful.
It's image. Really powerful. As we think through these three questions, is there anything else that you want to add to the why are we here or what are we here for, Joel?
Yeah, I mean, the why are we here and the what are we here for is really this idea of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul is talking to the church in Corinth, and he says, hey, you and I are ambassadors of Christ,
mm-hmm.
you know? Mm-hmm. And the language is so powerful. It's so that Christ can make his appeal in and through us. Mm-hmm. So if Christ is making his appeal in and through us, then the next question is like, okay, so what do we do about this, right? So we know who we are, we know what we're here for, and now the question is, what do we do about it? And then it's like, how do you and I make clear the presence of God in our lives, in the spaces that we're in, you know, mm-hmm. In our work, in our family, when we're in the car rider line waiting to pick up our kids and life is chaotic and messy. Mm-hmm. My family's going on vacation tomorrow and I'm already stressed out, y'all. I'm already stressed
out. Are you specifically stressed about the packing, the car ride, getting there?
I'm getting more stressed as you just described. of the things that
you're like, yes.
They're like, oh, wait, I hadn't even thought
all
about
of
that.
The above. All of the above. Okay. Circled the whole thing. Okay. And so like, here's the question. Well,
but you're like, I'm going on vacation. Like, why should I be?
Well, here, this is a side tangent. I'm pretty convinced that the concept of vacation only makes sense for children. For the rest of us as adults.
Or
really,
adults without children.
Or. Yeah, maybe. But even, yeah, I mean, that's
like Victoria and I.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, like, because my vacation is basically making sure my children are on vacation while I take care of them and they have a great time. And
see, I would call that a trip. I feel like trips and vacations are two different things.
Yeah, you're going on a trip.
Yeah, I'm going on a trip.
Going on a trip.
My children are going on a vacation.
But you are going on a trip.
And I that's and my a good perspective wife are professional shift for you, chauffeurs for my children. As they're going on their vacation.
Activity planners.
On a trip. Yeah. You
know, okay. So they're professional activity
planners. But here's a really important question for me that I need to think about that Britt and I will talk about is, okay, how do we show Jesus to our kids?
Mm.
Like very transparently, when an hour and 15 minutes goes in And I know the first noise I'm going to hear from the back, because the kids have all gone to the bathroom. We know, like, we're pro parents. We know that the first thing that we do before we do a road trip is all the kids go to the bathroom. And that should give us a good 3 hours at least before the first stop. And then I can, and I already know who it is. And my son, I love you if you're hearing this, Luke, like little Lukey Bear. He'll be like, and here's what I actually think is happening. I actually think his two older brothers are putting him up to it because they think that, like, he won't get in trouble.
You have to be the one.
Yes. Yeah. And he'll say, hey, Dad.
He's the ambassador of the car that needs.
Yeah. And it's like when I'm annoyed and I'm frustrated, I'm like, you know better. How in that moment do I show the kindness and the compassion and the mercy of Jesus even to my children who really are throwing me all kinds of out of
who aren't just going to want to make a bathroom stop but are also going to ask you for a snack in the gas station.
Exactly.
And that's another opportunity, like you're saying, of how do I show Jesus even through this frustration or, you know, all of those opportunities. I think that's great. Mm. So would you say, as we are, I guess, making our way through life here on earth, that's like our primary goal or question we can ask ourselves is, how can I show Jesus as an ambassador to this world, these people, through my job, all of that?
Yeah, I think so. And I also think that we need to take Jesus's words very seriously. When Jesus teaches us how to pray, he says, on earth, the entire thing is framed this way, on earth as it is in heaven, right? Mm-hmm. And so the idea is that the kingdom of heaven is an actual kingdom with an actual king who sits on a throne, and this king and kingdom have actual people. And every king and every kingdom has ethics, values, systems. And the image that Jesus gives us is the image of the invasion, the incoming of this kingdom onto earth as it is now. And so the question is like, oh, when, you know, this happened just yesterday. I was on a flight coming home and I was sitting down and there's a gal who had just gone on, and I know how to travel compact and like with the bags. I mean, sis had a bag that I don't know how she made it through TSA, but this thing was huge and it was heavy and she is all disheveled, you know? And as she's walking by, like, we know this moment, right? It's like,
I'm like,
she's,
wait,
so
was this
disheveled.
Me on this
I was going to say, I have been the sis.
I too but feel, like,
I'm an aisle guy. Like, you've asked this question of Lisa and I before,
yeah, like,
Shae, you know?
Aisle.
She's a window, I'm an aisle. I like to have control. I like to get it right. Now, here's the downside of the aisle. In this situation, you're getting beat up. Yeah. Like, the bag is hitting you, the purse is hitting you, and sweet lady, she had turned, the bag hit me in the head. You know, and I'm like getting annoyed, and I'm getting frustrated. And then she's got to, like, you know, she's got to take this suitcase and she's got to lift it up. And I could just tell, and everybody else is annoyed, and then, you know, and I had this like moment where I was just like, I believe in honesty at all costs. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you're a theologian, you shouldn't think this. I'm just gonna be, I was like, I can't wait to watch her struggle. Like, no!
That's so savage.
I was like, man, I've got a headache now. I'm like this. And then I was like,
and were you kind of thinking, like, that's what you get for packing all that stuff?
Yeah, yeah. And then I was like, and so I unbuckled, said, hey, can I, you know? She's like, and I was like, I got it. And I blinked, and it was heavy. I think my bicep is still strained from trying to lift this thing and put it. But it's like, okay, how do I show in a very practical, tangible way that the kingdom of God is invading through the people of God, even in a place like an airplane, when I don't want to do that? I'm annoyed. I'm ready to be home with my family. And yet a momentary act of kindness could be a thing that just sets the gal up for some success throughout the rest of the day. I don't know what happened before, what's going to happen afterwards. And so from a practical place, it's like, man, these are opportunities that we as image bearers of God have in order to give other people a tangible experience of what God's kingdom is going to be like. Mm-hmm. And when I think they experience that, it opens up a door for conversation where it's like, man, why'd you do that? And it's like, well, I really believe in what Jesus says. Mm-hmm. And now it's like, you know, like, preach the gospel at all times, you know?
And when necessary is worth
it. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a horrible quote, by the way. St. Francis of Assisi actually never said that, is the first thing. And I think the better quote
this
is like,
why I never share anything.
It's like, preach the gospel.
I love this sentiment.
No, it's a good sentiment, but it's
you,
like,
in my defense, you did share half the quote.
I did share. I kind of led you into that.
Yeah. I thought you were baiting me.
No. Preach the gospel at all times and always use your words.
Yeah, for sure.
You know,
sure.
It's like, it's not an either always, or. It's
totally.
Both and.
No,
and,
you're right.
Those things should come
to I like that you're using like very everyday examples, because I could imagine if I was just listening to this today, I would maybe think like, well, you guys all work in a ministry, like y'all are showing Jesus to the world every single day. But we, as we were preparing for this episode, we also talked about kind of the difference between like calling and vocation, which I don't know if either of y'all want to share, even if it's 30,000 foot view of that. But like, I really like that you're giving these everyday examples of an opportunity where like you have every right to be frustrated or every opportunity to kind of stay to yourself, but you chose to like enter in and kind of bring the presence of Jesus into those situations.
Yeah, love that. I have a question for you, Joel. As you were talking, you mentioned the Lord's Prayer and you said on earth as it is in heaven. And we've had conversations about, you know, new heaven, new earth. Like for someone who maybe is like newer to that like concept, like what is new earth? Like what is that? What exactly does that mean? Can you unpack that a little bit more?
Yeah. Question. Yeah. Well, here's my first question. I'm gonna do the good rabbi thing, right? Like ask a question, respond with a question. So when you think of heaven, what do you think of? Like what's your mental picture? Like not with many years of studying with us together. But like, you know what I mean? Like growing up, like you're in a junior high school kid, the first time you kind of hear about heaven, what would be like that first picture?
I mean, I think of all the paintings that are in like old churches or even just like storybooks, you know, that are very like angelic and lots of light, lots of singing, you know, just like it's just a very, it seems like a very happy like party, honestly, and everyone kind of looks like angels.
Very ethereal.
Yes.
Not like physical, not tangible at all, which I feel like you're going to get to. It's like an important point. But everything you said, like totally, that's what pops into my head.
Okay, look at the bookend of the Bible. We start in a literal physical garden. It's the place where God and humanity meet. And then in Revelation 21 and 22, it's like, the garden comes back. And now it's no longer a garden. It's a city, right? And where is the city? The city seems to be on the new heavens, the new earth. So the language of Scripture is new heavens and new earth. And there has been, I'm not quite sure when, I'm sure somebody has written some book or dissertation or something about like, when did we get to this ethereal, cloudy, we're all angels floating in wings? Like, when did that happen? I'm not quite sure, but I'll just let y'all know, like, as kindly and compassionately as I can, that ain't it, sis. Like, that's not the picture.
Yeah.
The picture is, I think a closer picture is Eden. And the thought that, and I call this an escapist theology, the thought that we escape out somewhere and leave this bad, horrible earth away is like antithetical to Scripture. That's not the presentation of what Scripture has. In fact, I think, we were talking about this earlier, Victoria, I think that C.S. Lewis describes what the new heavens and new earth will look like the best at the very ending scene of the last battle. And it's this picture of all of these things that are fading away, but also being transformed and becoming new with still the very presence of what they were. And the things that faded away were the things that were corrupted by sin that were unredeemable, right? Those things are gone. But the things that were good, the things that are beautiful and yet still broken because of sin, in this beautiful way, in the new heavens, the new earth, these things are redeemed and they're restored. And they're almost made like, they are made brand new, but you don't forget the context of which you experienced that goodness originally, you know? And so this is what the new heavens and the new earth are. It's not a disembodied, angelic-like, spiritualized deal. It is embodied. Like Jesus in the incarnation was embodied. Like he let you touch his hands. He let you touch the side. He was eating on a beach. Like, that is the picture of what the new heavens and the new earth are. And I think that's actually incredibly important for this conversation of exile. Because when we think about exile, it's like, do we just endure? Like, are we just here and like, we just gotta like survive till we get out of here? But if we think about the beauty and how that beauty is gonna be redeemed and restored, it actually puts weight, value, and worth to the things that we're doing right now. You know, to be like good stewards of God's creation here on earth right now, that thing is going to actually make an impact into eternity.
I'm glad that you asked that question, because I think if there are listeners, which I'm sure there are on the other side on the other side of this conversation today, they're listening to this and they've never heard what you just talked about, you know? I hope that that breaks a lot of fear that I think sometimes can be around, like, the afterlife. And, you know, we don't have time to get into all that today, but I'm glad that you kind of dispelled, like, where we've very much departed and gone from this. So, Victoria, I know that you've done a lot of studying on this topic of exile and even just asking about the new heavens and the new earth. And so I want to give you the floor to share anything that you want to.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks for, diving into that, Joel. I feel like I definitely was in the, like, angels floating around sort of, like, camp of what I
that
thought.
That was the era we grew up in, Sunday
truly,
school, for
truly,
sure.
Yeah. Whether that was, like, the intention or not, that's, like, what my takeaway was. But over the last, like, 5-10 years, I really keep coming back to this, you know, the new earth, like, sort of concept. And, like, mm-hmm. Okay, what does that mean for me today? Because I feel like things can feel, you know, we've talked about things here that's very 30,000 feet and we're kind of in the like 15,000 feet, you know, area right now. Okay. And we're going to get to the ground level make it a little bit more practical. That concept of what we do here on earth in this life and how it really matters, has become so important to me. And to your point, Shae, like, taking away fear that I have and also given me so much freedom, because I think we as believers can make God so small and put him in a box. But he is so limitlessly creative, and there's this such vision of all the different ways that he's created our world and our earth that we just don't even think about. And so for me, whenever I'm thinking about this concept, I'm thinking about, like, okay, so what I do here on earth really matters. So what does that mean? Well, I think there's so many different ways that we can work, whether that's paid or unpaid, here on this earth, that is an act of worship to the Lord. Mm-hmm. And so that act of worship to the Lord, you know, Joel, when you were talking about the things that will fade away or pass away, those things that are done on this earth that are an act of worship to the Lord will stay, and maybe they'll be transformed because they're not, you know, there's still brokenness there, but they will remain and be an echo in eternity. So that could look like a beautiful piece of art that is created here, that is literally us, like, the Lord is a creator, and that is us as humans, how we were wired, how the Lord created us to mirror his creation as our creator. A beautiful piece of art. Maybe it's packing a healthy lunch for your kids to go to school so it fills up their bellies with good food, and so their brains are ready to absorb the information that they need to get at school. Or maybe it's you faithfully doing your work in a cubicle in some sort of financial office where that industry would be really easy to fall prey to greed, or climbing a social ladder, climbing the corporate ladder. Thank you. Chasing prestige. You know, there's so many different ways that we can do our work in a way that's worship to the Lord. And those are the things that will be present on the new earth. And I think that's really cool. And actually, J.R. Tolkien wrote a short story that I think illustrates this in a really cool way. The main character of the short story is a painter, and he has this vision in his mind of this beautiful tree that he wants to paint, all the colors and textures. And that is what he wants to do. He's an artist. He wants to paint this beautiful tree. And every time he goes to paint, he's at his canvas. Every time he goes to paint, something comes up. There's a neighbor who comes by, and he needs help. So the main character has to go and help him. Or there's a storm coming, and he needs to repair his roof and, you know, board up the windows because the storm is coming. So he has to go spend time doing that. And he only has time to paint one leaf. On this big, beautiful tree, this whole vision that he has, he only gets one leaf done before someone comes to him and he has to go on the long trip, which AKA means he's dying. It's a metaphor, but, you know, so he goes on this long trip he's not able to finish his leaf or his tree. He just gets the leaf done. But what happens when he arrives in his destination after the long journey is he walks into this big, beautiful field, and there's his tree physically there. The tree that he had always imagined in his mind is there waiting for him after in his, you know, in this scenario of eternity. And I just think that's such a beautiful reminder of how what we do here really and truly does matter. And I always think, I try to think of that and remember that whenever I, you know, I'm just toiling about on this earth and I'm like, is this, does this have purpose? Like, what is the purpose of folding this laundry or like planting this garden in, you know, my backyard or whatever, you know?
Yeah, everything can be seen as an act of worship. Like, I think about old people that I'll encounter and you'll say, like, how are you? They're like, oh, I'm just passing through, you know? And it's like, while there's some truth to that, like, we're not here forever. Like, we are not stuck here to just wait until it's our time to go to heaven. Like, God has asked us and given us opportunities to bring his presence or to show his presence to the world.
Yeah.
Or these different acts of worship that you're talking about.
Yeah.
I love that story because I think even, you know, the way that Tolkien works often is he's given us this story, these illustrations, and they're meant to almost be flexed, you know, a bit and to let our imagination run with it. And even as I've heard you share the story before, Victoria, but even just now as you're saying it, some new things came up where I was just thinking like, okay, there's a difference between vocation and calling, you know? There's this vocation which can shift and change over seasons and times. But then there's like calling. And for me, I even separate calling between capital C calling and lower C calling. Well, what do I mean by that? Well, I think the calling of every believer of Jesus is that 2 Corinthians 5 to make the presence of Jesus, to be ambassadors of Christ, that he's making his appeal in and through us. And then the lower C calling is just a bit more individualized to us. And I would connect the lower C calling with the gifts of the Spirit. You know, God gives us gifts, and these gifts are meant for the edification of God's people and the glorification of God himself. And just as an exercise, if you're going out with your girlfriends and you're going to sit down and hang out and talk, like one of the best things that you might do with them is like go to, you know, Galatians 5 and look at the fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, the different passages, and maybe ask a friend and say, hey, what gifts do you see in me? Mm-hmm. You know, and allow them to speak into you. And then what you'll find is that this calling will often be able to be flexed out vocationally in what you're doing. Now, the vocation can change in various
and
seasons.
And it often does.
And it often does. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But what confidence and what like comfort to know that even if your vocation is flexing and changing in places that you maybe didn't even want it to change in, the calling remains consistent. And with this story, I just think about drawing that leaf. I'm like, man, I wonder what, how this guy would feel like. You know, for me, it'd be like writing a chapter of something and never getting finished the entire book, you know? And like, what would happen? And I'm like, well, and I think this is maybe what Tolkien is getting at, is every act, everything that he was distracted with was actually a participation of the fulfillment of that tree, right? Even though he didn't get to physically draw it out, in a way he was living it out. And so when he gets to the new heavens and the new earth, he sees the tree, and then we get to, like, for us today, we get to see, oh, just because we have a view of how this can get done in the economy of God's kingdom, man, he is, like what you said, Victoria, endlessly creative. Right. And so that very vision can actually happen through a variety of means. Obedience and faithfulness is the goal.
I think it also like shows how God plants those desires and dreams and visions for things, for those longings for more, like in the human heart, you know, and then he fulfills them.
And how exciting to think about that. Like, you know, my brain kind of does flips on itself when I'm thinking about it. But like, okay, I have these big dreams and these big visions, and on this side of heaven, if they don't like come to fruition, like that's okay. Like, who knows what is going to come in this new heaven and new earth. It just makes me think, like, you know, God's playing, we're playing checkers and God's playing chess, you know?
And it just ultimately, like, it's not for nothing, you know. So as we wrap up today, Victoria, help us land the plane in a practical way to kind of tie all this together.
Okay, so we can get down to the ground level now.
Okay, we're here. We have arrived.
I love staying at the 30,000 foot, but then I think in me, I feel the the angst of like, okay, but what do I do
sure.
with all of this? Mm-hmm. So there's actually a really great book that I recommend. I'm going to hold it up for our friends online. Oh, no, my notes. It's called Exiles on Mission by Paul S. Williams. And I feel like this would, if you want to learn more about this topic, I feel like this is a great resource. But he has a really great quote in here that I feel like will kind of tee us up for our end of our conversation. And it's about, it's after the exile of Babylon, the story with Daniel and all that, if you're familiar. And so I'm just going to read this quote quickly. When the Jewish exiles finally returned from Babylon to Jerusalem, they found the city in ruins. Under the leadership of Nehemiah, they began the task of rebuilding walls, gates, and later houses of the city. This is the key part. Each family and occupational group had a specific part of the city wall to rebuild, and that's in Nehemiah 3 and 4. Western society is in a state of spiritual disrepair. Its walls are broken down. God's heart is to see it reconciled to him in Christ. So here's the question. Which part of the wall is God sending you to rebuild, cultivate, grow, start something new? What, you know, how does that question hit y'all?
Yeah, like I think for me, I think of like, where does God have me, have us, me, whoever, on assignment right now?
Mm-hmm.
Joel, do you want to go first?
Yeah, I mean, I think of Acts 17, 26 through 29, and it's like, it's not random or by chance mm-hmm. that you live in the geographical areas that you live in or the times that you exist in. And so for me, just on a practical level, like I'll circle back to like, okay, tomorrow I'm going to be in a minivan mm-hmm. with my kids. And it's like, how can I, when I am annoyed and when I do want to lose it, how can I be constrained and held accountable by the Holy Spirit so that it hopefully is going to create an echo in their heart so that when they grow up to be husbands, fathers, a wife, MJ, a mom, like that is an echo in their hearts for when they're going to have that same moment with their kids, you know, and they're like, oh, yeah, I remember when dad, like I did the same stuff and this is how dad responded. And so for me, it's just like very practical. And I think, again, I think momentarily, immediately, and I think what often God's trying to do to us is help us to see eternally or even generationally. And so that, from a practical level, has helped me just tomorrow when I'm going to prep to go on vacation or a trip. My kids go on vacation.
There you go. Yeah. So that's great. Yeah. I think that's really good. I think my brain can get lost of a 30,000 foot, even part of this question of just making this like, it's a really big question to think about. But I think right now, I think where God has me on assignment is, I'm going to just answer kind of outside of my job, kind of like you did, Joel. But I have a lot of friends that are in a season of either having their, most of them are having their first child.
Yeah.
And so I think God has placed me in a unique position to have the white space to be able to come alongside them and support them in a way that if I had children of my own right now, I wouldn't be able to do that. And so thinking about, I have friends that are, you know, due in July and August and September, and even my own sister this fall. And so really just leaning into the white space that God's given me to be like a support role for them in that, whether that's like getting their grocery order when I'm going to the grocery store, or just kind of checking in those like first couple of months when, you know, it's a lot, and not just checking in on the baby, but also checking in on the mom. And so that was just one thing that came to mind for me of where I feel like God's asking me to step into that space.
Yeah. Yeah. I love both of those because they're so like specific and practical to like where both of y'all are, like life stage wise, mm-hmm. like your roles in your families and your communities. And as I think about this question, I kind of feel like I'm at like a life stage where I'm sort of on the precipice of like, I don't quite know. Like, I feel like I have been on assignment, you know, and I have like been, you know, cultivating, growing, building in the areas that the Lord has called me in. And those, like, that season is like finished, and I'm kind of standing on the edge. I'm like, okay, Lord, what next?
What's next? Yeah.
You know, like, where are you wanting me to show up?
Mm-hmm.
And so I kind of feel like I'm talking to the Lord about those questions. I was just reading in Joshua this morning, and a Bible that I'm reading, there's like some devotional questions, and it's just asking like, where, you know, is the Lord like the center of your life, and what does that look like?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's talking about like dividing up the tribes of Israel and all that. geographically. And so I'm just kind of on the edge of like, okay, I don't really know what's next, but like I'm talking to the Lord about that. So I feel like this is a very good, like, timely podcast for us to talk through.
Yeah.
And for me.
That's great. Yeah. Is there anything that we didn't say that you guys want to share before we wrap up on this conversation of exile, new heavens, new earth? I mean, we always talked about Eden. I mean, I think we kind of low-key covered the whole story, didn't we?
The whole story of Scripture.
Yeah, we did.
One podcast episode. I would just, even, you know, hearing you, Victoria, that you say that, I think patience is such a massive component in it. And I think we live in a society where either we have this urgency to get to the next thing, and we almost become a bit careless and reckless because we just want to do the next thing.
Yeah.
Or the pendulum swing is we are so stressed out about the potential and possibility that when we do know it's the time to make the move, we still wait, you know, because of a fear of what might happen. And I think one of the things that is so helpful, like with the context of exile and all the things we've been talking about, the vocation and calling, is patience is only as powerful as what we are actually practicing while we're being patient, you know. And I heard a couple of things that you said, you know, like you're waiting on the Lord, you're talking to him. I know you know, outside of the podcast episode and just like as friends and coworkers, you've got a strong community, you're involved in your church, and all of those things are the things that you practice in the midst of that patience, so that when God says, all right, let's take the first step, you're like, all right, I'm going to be obedient to take that step. And so like the exile is meaningful. Exile has purpose. God is actually cultivating and creating in us something of extreme importance and worth, because that thing will actually transition and flow into eternity.
That's so good. That was a great way, I think, to end that, is just to talk about the patience that comes with enduring life on the side of eternity, and honestly, too, the excitement and the endurance as we look ahead to what's to come, to the new heavens and the new earth. So Joel, Victoria, thank you so much for your time today. I know that we talked a lot about some things that we're going to put in the show notes, like some extra resources and things that we want to link to. And so make sure if you're interested in that, that you visit all the links in the show notes. And thanks for tuning in to another episode on the Proverbs 31 Ministries podcast. We hope it blessed you today.